السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين، نبينا محمدٍ وعلى آله وصحبه والتابعين ومن تبعهم بإحسانٍ إلى يوم الدين، وبعد. We praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We send blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his entire household and all his companions. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless them all and bless every single one of us. And may he grant us all cure from the sicknesses and illnesses that we may be facing. Ameen. My brothers and sisters, we are going through the verses of the Quran and going through some of the reasons of revelation of some of these verses. And yesterday I had promised you that I would start off by making mention of the story of the key of the Kaaba. And this narration is made mention of by Ibn Mardaway, narrated by Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu. And there is another narration which is made mention of by Al-Wahidi rahmatullahi alayhi in his book known as Reasons of Revelation. He has a book known as Asbabun Nuzul. So there are two narrations. And the reason why I make mention of the fact that there are two separate narrations is because the person involved, known as Uthman ibn Talha, there is a discrepancy as to whether he accepted Islam upon the victory of Mecca or whether he accepted Islam just prior to the victory of Mecca, between Hudaybiyah and the victory of Mecca. There is also a question as to whether it is exactly the same person, because some make mention of Uthman ibn Talha and some say Uthman ibn Abi Talha. So if it is the nephew and the uncle, then they are two different people. However, let's go with the common narration of Al-Wahidi, and thereafter I'll make quick mention of the other narration as well. He says, at the time of the victory of Mecca, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam entered Mecca, and one of the most important things to be done was to get to the Kaaba, to open it, to remove the idols and so on. This was an extremely important event. When he entered Mecca tul Mukarrama, he actually entered with so much of humility that his head was so low, it was close to the neck of the camel. Unlike other leaders, if they were to enter victorious, there would be a pompous entry with a lot of fanfare surrounded by this entry. With Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he knew that this is the point of success. It is victory from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If Allah wanted, there would have been no victory here. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us victory at all times and to protect us from all forms of defeat and loss. Ameen. So my brothers and sisters, when he entered Makkatul Mukarrama, one of the first things he did was he asked for the key of the Kaaba, and he asked for Uthman ibn Talha. The reason why Uthman ibn Talha was because this man's family from generations had been responsible for the key of the Kaaba. They used to keep it, and it used to run down the family. Everyone knew that this family holds the key. Uthman ibn Talha, when he heard that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was entering Makkatul Mukarrama, he climbed up above the Kaaba trying to hide, and he had locked the Kaaba and he took the keys with him. So what happened is, he went up with the key. They were looking for him. When they found him, Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu found him, and amazingly, sorry, I'm just distracted by the light here. I think it happens every day, my brother. We need to be a little bit more wary of that, inshallah. So Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu went up and he looked for Uthman ibn Talha. And what happened, he found him at the top of the Kaaba and he asked him for the key. And he refused. He said, look, I'm not giving you the key. So according to the narration of Al-Wahidi, he became a little bit aggressive. Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu took it by force. And he rushed down and he gave Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam the key. They opened the Kaaba, mashallah, they went in. And obviously Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the long story, he read two raka'at of salah and so on. And as he came out, he met his uncle Al-Abbas ibn Abdul Muttalib. And Al-Abbas ibn Abdul Muttalib sees the key of the Kaaba. And he says, O Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you know, we are responsible for the Zamzam, and for feeding, or should I say for quenching the thirst of the Hujjaj, those who come to this house, we are responsible for quenching their thirst. Subhanallah. And if you were to give us this key, the honor would be doubled. As you know, we are one family. You know, he's the uncle of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Give us the key. The honor will be doubled. It will be a double honor for us. We will have the key as well as the responsibility of the Zamzam. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam at that juncture received revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. According to Umar ibn al-Khattab radiyallahu anhu, the verse was revealed inside the Kaaba. Narration of Umar ibn al-Khattab radiyallahu anhu, he says, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was coming out of the Kaaba, he was busy reading this verse and we had never heard it before. Meaning, it was revealed inside the Kaaba. So what is the verse? Verse number 58 of Surah An-Nisa.
إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُكُمْ أَن تُؤَدُّوا الْأَمَانَاتِ إِلَىٰ أَهْلِهَا.
Allah instructs you to return that which is entrusted to those whom it belongs to. If you are entrusted with something, you return it to the one whom it belongs to. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam called Ali ibn Abi Talib radiyallahu anhu and says, go back to Uthman ibn Talha, call him and apologize to him because of the manner in which you had treated him earlier, and give him back the key. So Ali ibn Abi Talib radiyallahu anhu goes to Uthman ibn Talha, and the man was concerned, he was worried, because moments earlier there was a little bit of harshness in dealing with him, and now suddenly there was an apology, there was some beautiful speech, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's instruction was fulfilled. Ali ibn Abi Talib radiyallahu anhu goes and returns this beautiful key, and he says, oh Uthman, this is the key. And he's surprised. He said, moments ago you were quite aggressive and now you are apologizing and coming with this key. What's happening? He says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has revealed verses regarding you, and these are the verses. Inna Allaha ya'murukum an tu'addu al-amanati ila ahliha. Allah has instructed you to fulfill the trust to those whom it belongs to. And according to the narration of Al-Wahidi, that is the point where Uthman ibn Talha accepted Islam. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us goodness. He obviously understood that this is an issue of trust. It is something that is higher than, or thicker than, blood. Although Al-Abbas ibn Abdul Muttalib, being the family of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, was requesting the same key, it was not given to him. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, one step further, he told Uthman ibn Talha, and this is according to all the narrations, he said, nobody shall take this key from you and your progeny up to the end of time, except the one who is an oppressor. So my brothers and sisters, just for sake of information, to this day, the same family holds the key, subhanallah. The same family holds the key of the Kaaba. And this is evidence enough to prove the existence of whatever we've been saying regarding Makkah al-Mukarramah and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is the family. So the other narration, which I had made mention of just in passing, Ibn Mardawayh, the narration of Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, he says that Uthman ibn Talha was already a Muslim, but he was fearing that the key might be snatched away from his family. So that is why he was a little bit apprehensive when it came to giving the key. And later on he gave the key, and the story continues as per the other one. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us a lesson, and may we be from amongst those who can return what does not belong to us to those whom it belongs to, no matter what it is. A lot of the times in our case, I think it would be wealth. Sometimes we owe a little bit of money to people and it doesn't ever go back to them. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us and may He strengthen us. Verse number 60 of Surah An-Nisa, a beautiful verse where mention is being made of the sickness that lies within certain people. Today, if I have a problem with you, we are both Muslimin, what is the proper way of resolving it? I need to look at what Allah says. I need to look at what Islam says. I need to look at what the Sharia says, and perhaps I need to resolve the matter that way, because we are believers. But sometimes people are weak. Do you know what they do? They look at whether they are gaining or not by going to resolve the matter according to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If they are gaining, they say, no problem, let's go to the ulama, let's go and sort it out, let's go to this panel, let's go to so and so, and we're mentioning names of all scholars of Islam, because we know that we're going to get something when we go there. And the minute we know we're going to lose, I'm taking you to court. Even the scholars of Islam sometimes have a weakness where they want to take another to court because they did not resolve their matter according to Allah and His Rasul. It's a weakness. Shaitan is bad. Remember, the bottom line, people are good, always. Shaitan is bad. So therefore, he makes them bad temporarily. Sometimes that temporarily is a little bit long. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. We're trying to look at it as positive as possible. So my brothers and sisters, there was a Muslim who had a dispute with a Jewish man at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And this narration is mentioned by Ibn Jarir, and he has narrated it from a Sha'bi. So he says, the Jewish man said, I want to go to your Prophet for justice because I know he won't take a bribe and I know he will speak the truth, and I want to go to your people. And the Muslim man, who was very weak, he says, no, I'd like to go to a certain fortune teller from amongst you guys. Allahu al-musta'an, Allahu Akbar. Imagine when you know that someone accepts a bribe, quick to go there, you know, put a little bit in his hand and just tell him, hey, you know the story. He says, I know. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. Allahu Akbar. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us. You know, bribery and corruption is destroying nations upon nations. And this is something that has become a problem, a menace. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us all. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help improve our nations. Or may He improve our nations. Ameen. So, when that happened, verses were revealed exposing this man. Verse number 60 of Surah An-Nisa. أَلَمْ تَرَ إِلَى الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا نَصِيبًا مِّنَ الْكِتَابِ أَلَمْ تَرَ إِلَى الَّذِينَ يَزْعُمُونَ أَنَّهُمْ آمَنُوا بِمَا أُنزِلَ إِلَيْكَ وَمَا أُنزِلَ مِن قَبْلِكَ يُرِيدُونَ أَن يَتَحَاكَمُوا إِلَى الطَّاغُوتِ وَقَدْ أُمِرُوا أَن يَكْفُرُوا بِهِ. Allah says, do you see the one who claims that he believes in Allah? He believes in that which has revealed to you and that which was revealed before you. But he has gone to the taghut in order to achieve justice, and he has been instructed to disbelieve in it. When it comes to justice, look at what he's done. He's gone somewhere where he thinks that regarding this worldly life, I'm going to achieve something. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. Brothers and sisters, if you receive that which does not belong to you, remember it is a piece of the fire. You have the option of taking it, consuming it, and being served the punishment, or leaving it, being honest, and perhaps suffering a small loss in this world, but you have succeeded in the life after. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala replace whatever has been taken from us with that which is even better. Ameen. Then verse number 65 of Surah An-Nisa, also something extremely interesting. The hadith is made mention of, it is muttafaqun alayh. What is the meaning of muttafaqun alayh? It is upon the highest level of authenticity. Imam Bukhari and Imam Muslim, rahmatullahi alayhima, they have mentioned it. When both of them have mentioned the narration, it is called muttafaqun alayh. The highest level of authenticity. The statement is absolutely accurate. So, verse number 65, if we look at the story behind it, Abdullah ibn Zubayr, who was the cousin of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he had a dispute with a certain man. Some narrations make mention of the name, but the authentic narration doesn't have the name of the next man. He had a dispute regarding water. You know, the water belonged to Abdullah ibn Zubayr radiallahu anhu, and he used to use it for his field, for his orchard. And as it came, it was up to him to give it to the next man, to use a little bit less and send it perhaps for the next man to benefit from. So the other man took him to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and told him, this man is not sharing the water with me. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told his cousin Abdullah ibn Zubayr radiallahu anhu, he says, you know what, why don't you take some water for yourself and then let it go and let him also benefit from the water. So this man, he was a little bit surprised. I don't know for what reason. He wanted the water for himself. And he says, oh Muhammad, are you being lenient on him solely because he's your cousin? Listen to this. Telling the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that you are bending justice because this man is the cousin of yours. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's color changed. He became upset. Obviously, he was upset. He said, "Oh, Abdullah ibn Zubayr, take the water and don't give him anything. Because now this is justice. Initially, I was trying to be lenient. What did not belong to that man, I was trying to tell you to give him some. But since he is being a person who wants to accuse us of taking sides because of blood and because of relation, we want to tell you real justice is that it is your water, you don't have to give him anything." Subhanallah. Now the man felt bad. Obviously, because now, you know, they say he went for something that was not his and he lost even that which he thought was his. Subhanallah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed verses explaining that none of you are true believers until you make the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam the judge between you and your disputes. Whatever his decision is final, and you should feel good about it. You should not be feeling in your heart that there is anything wrong with this particular ruling of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Listen to this verse. Verse number 65 of Surah An-Nisa.
فَلَا وَرَبِّكَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ حَتَّى يُحَكِّمُوكَ فِي مَا شَجَرَ بَيْنَهُمْ ثُمَّ لَا يَجِدُوا فِي أَنفُسِهِمْ حَرَجًا مِمَّا قَضَيْتَ وَيُسَلِّمُوا تَسْلِيمًا.
Indeed, by your Rabb, they are not considered true believers until they make you the judge in their disputes. And then they find no negative feeling in their hearts regarding the judgment. You have to feel that this judgment, not only is it correct, but I'm so happy. I'm so happy to be surrendering to what was the decision of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. My brothers and sisters, many of us, when we are told what Allah says, when we are told what the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said, we find it difficult to accept. When it comes to matters of divorce, matters of child custody, matters, so many other matters, matters of business, we feel upset sometimes. We say, no, I'm not worried, it's okay. But someone is reading a verse for you. Someone is explaining the hadith for you. 20 people explained it to you. No, it's fine, it's okay. We need to learn from this verse that we cannot call ourselves true believers, if that is the case. How can you claim to be a follower of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you love him more than anything, and then you prove that it's only a claim, it's not really the truth. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the ability to surrender to the instructions of His and that of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then, talking about love and those who claim to love the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there is a narration mentioned in At-Tabarani by Aisha radiallahu anha. Some of the narrations make mention of the name, and I will say the name. Thawban was a young man and he loved Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam so much. One day he came and he was very, very sad. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asks him, "Oh Thawban, what's wrong? What is it?" He says, "Oh Messenger, I love you more than I love myself. When I look at you, I'm so happy. When I leave you, I cannot wait to get back to you. I love you more than myself and everybody else. And today I was busy thinking that I miss you so much while you are here and alive that I like to rush and come back and just watch your face. It brings about so much of calmness and coolness to my heart. And I was thinking on the day of judgment and later on, we will be separated because you are a prophet. You will be resurrected with the highest of the high and you will be going into Jannah. Even if I make it into Jannah, I'm going to be in a very, very low position. I'm not going to be in your standard. I'm not going to be in your level. You will be high with the other messengers and so on and the highest of the lot. And where will I be? And if I don't make it to Jannah, then perhaps we might never see you again. So that is why I'm sad." Subhanallah. Look at his concern. He says, "I'm going to miss you, O Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam." So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed verses in this regard. Verse number 69 of Surah An-Nisa. You want to make it to Jannah? You want to be in the companionship of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Do you want to be with those who are the pious and the predecessors, those who were companions of the Prophet, peace be upon him, of the highest level, the martyrs and so on? Well, the verse says, وَمَن يُطِعِ اللَّهَ وَالرَّسُولَ فَأُولَٰئِكَ مَعَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِمْ مِنَ النَّبِيِّينَ وَالصِّدِّيقِينَ وَالشُّهَدَاءِ وَالصَّالِحِينَ
وحسن أولئك رفيقا. ذلك الفضل من الله وكفى بالله عليما.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, whoever follows Allah and His Messenger, whoever follows Allah and His Messenger, he will be resurrected with those whom Allah has blessed from the prophets. So he will be resurrected with the prophets. And those who were truthful, as-siddiqeen, and those who were martyrs, as-shuhada, and those who were pious, as-saliheen. And that is the best companionship you could ever have. So if you want to be with Allah, or should I say resurrected with the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the others we just mentioned, what you need to do, follow Allah and His Rasul. وَمَنْ يُطِعِ اللَّهَ وَالرَّسُولَ فَأُولَٰئِكَ مَعَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِمْ. Follow Allah and His Rasul, and this is what will happen. Subhanallah, the tears that roll down the cheeks. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us such tears. This man, Thawban, was so, so touched. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us this love of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that makes us adopt the commands that he has come with and that makes us abstain from the prohibitions. Ameen. Verse number 59 of Surah An-Nisa, also a hadith muttafaqun alayhi, and I've explained what exactly that means by Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu and also explained by Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu. He says there was a man known as Abdullah ibn Hudhafa al-Sahmi radiallahu anhu. He was a companion of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he was placed as a leader for one of the platoons, and he had gone with a group of people upon the instruction of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told the people to listen and obey. Listen to this man and obey him because he is your amir, he is your leader basically. So as they went, Abdullah ibn Hudhafa radiallahu anhu, he became upset with them for some reason. So he gave them a weird instruction. What was the instruction? He told them, didn't the Messenger tell you to obey me sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? They said, yes. Okay, get some firewood. They got the firewood, light a fire. They lit a fire. Now jump into the fire. Wow, jump into the fire. So the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, those who were there, they looked at one another. They were holding back one another. They said, hey, we followed the Messenger to be saved from the fire, and this man is telling us to go into the fire. No ways. We're not going to go into this fire. No matter what. He can be the Amir. He can be whoever he wants. We're going back to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and we're going to ask him about this. So they went back to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and as I said, this narration is absolutely authentic. When they went back to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, do you know what he told him? He says, there is no obedience for a creature over the instruction of the Creator Himself. You cannot obey people when they instruct you to do something against the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says, had they entered the fire, they would have never come out of that fire up to the Day of Judgment. Because it is foolish. This shows us that when there is something absolutely unacceptable and it's gone totally against what Allah and His Messenger have taught, you do not obey those in authority over you. Subhanallah. Quite simple. And this is why the great narration, لا طاعة لمخلوق في معصية الخالق. There is no obedience for a creature over the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or in the disobedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So mashallah, what a beautiful incident. And this is made mention of, like I said, in the books of hadith. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the verses regarding this.
Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu ati'u Allah wa ati'u ar-rasul wa ulil amri minkum.
O you who believe, follow Allah and follow His Messenger, and follow those in authority over you. Obey them. It doesn't stop there. The verse continues.
فَإِن تَنَازَعْتُمْ فِي شَيْءٍ فَرُدُّوهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَالرَّسُولِ إِن كُنتُمْ تُؤْمِنُونَ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ.
If there is a dispute between you and the one in authority over you, then you go back to Allah and His Messenger only, and you remove the one in authority from the equation. So you're instructed to obey three categories: Allah, His Messenger, and those in authority. When there is a discrepancy between you and those in authority, go back to Allah and His Messenger, forget about those in authority. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us such that we, being in authority of a lot of people, every one of us here is in authority over someone, somewhere. Whether it's your children, your family members, and someone else, perhaps, maybe if you might be a child still, perhaps you are an exception. But once you become an adult, there are people. If you are, for example, a teacher in a classroom, you happen to be teaching children, you're in authority over them. Bear in mind what you instruct them. Let it never be against the instruction of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Similarly, those who are trying to become better Muslims and they want to dress according to Islam, or they want to fast properly, or they want to read their salah, or they want to do something that will please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's an instruction of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sometimes their folks make it difficult for them. I know of so many parents who've told their daughters who want to wear the hijab that, you know what, you're too young, you shouldn't do it. What will people say? At this time it's difficult to adopt Islam, so Allah will forgive you, don't worry. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. That's what people do. They sin and then they have hope in the mercy of Allah. How can we do that? A person says, don't worry, I will drink this alcohol, I know Allah is most forgiving. How do you know? You might die in the condition. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not do that to us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us all. A beautiful lesson we learn from that. Then the battle of Uhud took place and certain people were martyred. You know about that. So the hypocrites in Medina Munawwara, when these people returned, they passed a statement. They said, you know what? Had these who were martyred not gone out in the first place, they wouldn't have died, they would have been alive. They wouldn't have been killed, they would have actually been alive. Now that's a dangerous statement. Something has happened, people have passed away, and now you come and say, had they not done this, then this would have happened. That was the decree of Allah, no matter what. Let me tell you, my brothers and sisters, we cannot stop our lives thinking that I might die. Your life has to carry on, you still have to catch a flight. No one plans for anything to happen to that flight, but if something does happen, that was Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala perhaps. You have to drive on the road. You can't say, I'm not going to drive because I might die. Allah is telling us that you might even die in your own home. So what are you doing? Listen to the verse that was revealed. Verse number 78 of Surah An-Nisa. أَيْنَمَا تَكُونُوا يُدَرِكُمُ الْمَوْتُ وَلَوْ كُنْتُمْ فِي بُرُوجٍ مُشَيَّدَةٍ. No matter where you are, death will overtake you. If your time is up, it will come to you. Even if you happen to be upon the peaks of the towers that are well built and fortified. You want to be right at the top of Burj Khalifa, for example. Death will still come to you. For me, it's actually closer for the angel of death. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us, really. The point being raised is, no matter where you are, death will come to you. You continue with your life. Take the necessary precautions and keep on going. The necessary precautions, very important. Because you cannot say, okay, I'm jumping into this, I'm going to do a bungee jump without the rope. And I'll see, if death is written, it will happen. You're a fool. You take all precautions. You know, I'm skydiving without the parachute. What a fool. But if you've taken all necessary precautions by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, safety measures all intact, all in place, go ahead and continue. The same applies. Those who belong to an army or defending, for example, they cannot say, okay, we're not going. They are conscripted sometimes because that is how you will defend the nation. Every single nation has an army to protect it. So they cannot say, look, I'm not going to be joined because you know what? I don't know, I might die there. You might die. Look at Khalid ibn al-Walid radiallahu anhu. He took part in all major battles. And yet he died on his bed. Not in any one of those battles. And he says that, look, there is no place on my body except that it has gashes of wounds that have been afflicted during wars. And yet I'm dying on my deathbed. So let the cowards actually see. That means if someone is a coward and he doesn't want to be brave, let him learn a lesson that death will come to you no matter where it is meant to come to you. And if it is not meant to come to you, you can have jumped into the flame and still it won't happen. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not make us from those who jump into flames. Ameen. It's just an example, obviously. The last verse I want to speak about today, verse number 83 of Surah An-Nisa. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about something very important, a narration in Sahih Muslim. The earlier narration that I made mention of regarding the dying and the hypocrites and their comment of the people who were martyred in Uhud. was a narration of Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, mentioned by Al-Wahidi in his book Asbabun Nuzul. Then in Sahih Muslim, a narration of Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu, he says, I entered the masjid. Very important, quick lesson. I entered Masjid al-Nabawi and I heard the people, they were looking upset. They were playing with the soil. You know, when the dust, when people are upset, they take these small, like pellets, like small stones, and they hit them. And they were saying, the Prophet has divorced his wives. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has divorced his wives. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has divorced his wives. And yet that didn't happen. So Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu says, I stood up at the door and I started screaming loudly. His daughter was one of those who was married to the Prophet ﷺ. He says the Prophet ﷺ did not divorce his wives. And he repeated that a few times loudly. Why were they saying this? Just because the Prophet ﷺ stayed away from his wives for a period of time, rumor spread that all the wives are divorced. You know, people love rumor. So Allah reveals a powerful verse. Verse number 83 of Surah An-Nisa. Allah says, وَإِذَا جَاءَهُمْ أَمْرٌ مِّنَ الْأَمْنِ أَوِ الْخَوْفِ أَذَاعُوا بِهِ وَلَوْ رَدُّوهُ إِلَى الرَّسُولِ وَإِلَى أُولِي الْأَمْرِ مِنْهُمْ لَعَلِمَهُ الَّذِينَ يَسْتَنْبِطُونَهُ مِنْهُمْ. Allah says, whenever news of security, meaning good news, or news of fear, or bad news, comes to the hypocrites, their quality is that they broadcast it immediately. Any news comes to you, broadcast within 1 second, WhatsApp, BBM, everything, buzzing, Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, and you don't even know this news, you haven't even verified it, and it's gone one way, subhanallah. The whole world knows it, and then you realize, oh gosh, it was actually false. Now what do you do? They say the moon is making tawaf. Allahu Akbar. Have you heard that one? And the whole world thinks the moon is making tawaf at 3:25 a.m. You seen that one? May Allah forgive us. Allahul Musta'an. So this verse was revealed to say, had they returned that news to the messenger or to those who were able to understand it, perhaps they would have achieved or benefited from it. Or people would have known what it's all about. They would have been able to explain correctly. So yes, it was clarified at the time, but the lesson we have for ourselves, my brothers and sisters, let us not become trigger happy. You know, you hear something and immediately you forward it. Find out, take your time. You know, people have good news and immediately you want to tell the whole world. Take your time, make dua to Allah, thank Allah. Not everyone is going to be happy for your happiness, remember that. Not everyone is going to be sad for your sadness. Some people will become happy when you are sad. Some people will become angry when you are happy. Remember this, there are hypocrites out there. There are people who dislike you sometimes for no valid reason. They might have a reason just because of what you look like, but that's not a valid reason. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. So my brothers and sisters, remember this. Don't just broadcast everything and anything. Keep it to yourself for a while. See, if necessary, then let those who have to know, know. You know, sometimes people get engaged. That news of engagement, yes, it's brilliant. It's very, very good. MashaAllah, it's happy. And it's good to let people know. But I would say get your nikah done as soon as possible. Because today, the minute you get engaged and, you know, the norm, they want to prolong it until, I don't know, Christmas. May Allah forgive us. We don't even believe in it, so I don't know why they wait for it. But they wait for years on end. And you know what? By that time, 20 people have already contacted either side to tell them how bad the other side is, yet they are lying because they just want to see it broken. May Allah forgive us. It's happening. Same applies. A person has conceived after some years or after some time. Within 5 minutes of having checked that, hey, this person is now expecting, the whole dunya knows, and the next day they have a miscarriage, and then how do you face the world? May Allah forgive us. You don't need to tell the world. You don't need to go and broadcast all this information. Not at all. Keep it to yourself. Learn and understand. Some people, the only thing they have in terms of company is the mobile phone. And with that, even though they are stuck in their homes, they are in touch with more people across the globe than those who travel the globe. Really. And they give so much of information which is embarrassing, incorrect, and unnecessary. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. May He grant us wisdom. My brothers and sisters, we need a lot of wisdom. We need to understand. We need to think hard. before we relay news, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us a deeper understanding. وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد سبحان الله بحمده سبحانك اللهم بحمدك نشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت نستغفرك ونتوب إليك نستغفرك ونتوب إليك نستغفرك ونتوب إليك نستغفرك ونتوب إليك نستغفرك